much. Thank you, everybody. I died once. I got better. Thank you. Yeah. We'll talk about that a little later. First, I want to give you something. I want to give you a joke. Do you like to tell jokes?
Yeah, I do.
All right, this is for you. This is a clean joke. You can tell this joke anywhere. Okay. Guy goes to a doctor, and he tells the doctor that his back hurts. And the doctor asks him, oh, when you bend forward? And the guy says, no. And the doctor says, well, is it when you bend backwards? And the guy says, no. And the doctor says, well, is it side to side? And the guy says, no. And finally, the doctor says, well, you stumped me. When does it hurt? And the guy says, oh, it hurts when I do this. Do you get it? You tell it. Come on up. No? All right. Every good joke has got a kernel of truth at the center of it, and the truth at the center of that joke is just this. Most of our suffering is self-generated, and a lot of it is from self-defeating fear. Now, why should you believe me when I say that? Am I somebody special? Am I a man with strange gifts? A man with unusual abilities? No, I'm not. No. Be cool, but I'm not. One of those abilities I don't have is that I can't read people. Some people are great at that. They can just look at your face and they know what you're thinking. I don't know if somebody even likes me or not unless I ask them. Have you ever done that? Have you just flat out asked somebody if he likes you? It's a weird moment. Do you like me? You do? I like you too. Come here, hold me. That's beautiful. Wow. You see that? A lot of men don't have the courage to hug a strange man in public, and even fewer would have grabbed my butt like that. I feel very welcome now. But I'm serious. It's strange, I know, because of what I do, but I'm not good with people. And you seem like nice folks. I'd like to get to know you a little bit. What's your name, sir? Yeah. Brandon, and Brandon, what do you do? Do you have any idea? Yeah, it's all right. I know what you do. How are you doing?
I'm good.
Doing good compared to what? No, I mean we compare ourselves. Like, if you saw my other friend here walking down the street, would you think I'm doing better, worse, or about the same as that guy? What would you think? Worse? You're like going from 211 to 210 degrees. Watch it. You making a little money? You doing okay? What kind of car do you drive? We're all friends here. A Ford, nice car. What do you drive?
An Audi.
You are doing better. Come here.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, thank you. I'm sorry. This is just a game that I used to play, and the game was called "Who's Doing Better, Me or You?" And I was on one team, and the entire rest of the world was on the other team, and it sucked. It's probably why I was so rotten with people, but I needed people. And I reached out in my own strange way. I became a street performer. And all it really was a desperate attempt to get people to like me. Do you like me? Thought you might. I'm going to show you what I used to do when I was out there street performing. But first I have to say this. I'm not up here trying to show off, okay? I'm not up here trying to impress you. I just want to share with each and every one of you some of the amazing things that I can do and you cannot. Thank you. Now, I know there's some people wondering if the knives are real, so I brought some carrots along here. Nobody asked you. All right. One other thing. When I juggle knives in front of a large group of people, there's a statistical certainty that one or two folks will go home and try it. I'm sorry, but they do. That's why they have those things on TV, the disclaimers, don't try this at home. But somebody always does. It's always been that way. We even have a name for those people in show business. We call them morons. And I don't. I think if you want to learn how to juggle knives, wow, good for you. Good for you. In fact, I'm going to show you the method that I developed when I was learning to juggle knives. No one else learns this way. This was me. This is my gift to you. This is how I learned to juggle knives. Two knives in the right hand, one in the left. Right foot's forward. Weight's on the back foot. Ah! And then you just build up confidence from there. Anybody see where the third knife went? Oh, thank you. All right. It's nothing. No, it's a glare. Hang on a second. That's dangerous, actually. Hang on a second. It's farther back. Yeah, there it is. There you go. Okay. You can take it off. All right. That's a joke. I'm Jewish. I'm half Jewish. My mother's Jewish. My father's a Welshman. I'm a Welsh Jew. I'm the only one. I grew up slaving in a coal mine that I own. Okay. This is the basic three-knife juggling pattern. From this pattern, a master juggler can perform literally hundreds of amazing variations or tricks. I've seen them. They're neat. I used to do tricks to make this more dangerous for me and more exciting for you. And then I realized it was much easier just to make this more dangerous for you and a lot more exciting for me now. All right. I'm going to turn sideways here so you can see each knife is spinning once as it passes from hand to hand. This is the double spin. This may not look very hard, but you have to remember, I've been drinking since early this morning. Now wait, hang on to that applause. Good job. Oh, no, please. No, both of you, stop. I'm used to silence there. I've practiced for thousands of hours with nobody around, just myself, all alone. Same principle that made me a great lover. Thank you. A couple more tricks under the right leg with the right hand, under the left leg with the left hand, under the right leg with neither hand. It's a trick that's very beautiful, but it's very fast. Poof. Here it is again in slow motion. Whoa. And now, at a normal speed, yeah, yeah. And that is a little knife juggling. There you go. Thank you. Thank you very much. At this point, many people are asking themselves, are we renting that stage? Sorry, that'll seal right up. Seals right up. Many people asking themselves, well, what does this have to do with anything? He's juggling knives. I'm not going to juggle knives. What am I supposed to learn from this? Well, there's a principle involved here. People ask me how you juggle things like blades and fire. And the answer is, I don't. Nobody does. I juggle handles. The handle is the only thing that I'm looking at when I'm up here. The handle is a place where I can get a grip. The handle is a place where I can act or react. The handle is a place where you can push 211 degrees to 212 degrees. The handle. Every fear you've ever had has got a handle. And every time you were afraid, you were looking at the blade. And I know that every fear has a handle because I've had every fear. I was afraid of horses for a long time because when I was a kid, I got kicked in the head by a horse. And I was paralyzed for a week, and it was really weird because I was paralyzed from the waist up. So I could walk, but only all flopped over. Ended up scared to death of horses. You ever been horseback riding? Yes, did you chafe? Oh no, they don't tell you about that part. I was raw, and I wore the leather things. What do you call them? Chaps, yeah, it turns out you gotta wear pants under them. I didn't know, I grew up in San Francisco. Pants on top of pants, it seemed redundant. Even the name is kind of redundant. Horseback riding is more information than you need. I went horseback riding. Like if you told somebody you went horse riding, they'd ask you, where'd you sit? horseback riding. I went horseback riding. It was a date. It was supposed to be romantic. But the guy walked the horse out, and I knew there was trouble coming because he had big buggy eyes and some kind of goop in there. It's nasty, and there's big yellow teeth sticking out and sweat dripping off him. The horse looked really bad, too. I got on the wrong side. I didn't know there's a protocol. You're supposed to get on you're supposed to climb up the left? And I went up the front. I got his ears. There's a step in his mouth. You go, and I ended up sitting backwards on the horse. He was running. I was screaming. My date was chasing after us. She's yelling, "Relax, he can smell fear." I'm thinking that shouldn't be too tough because there's a big load of fear now. I tried to jump off the horse. I got a foot stuck in the stirrup, so I was swinging underneath the horse. So technically, I was horse belly riding now. I'm swinging underneath the horse, and I'm slipping, and I'm going to die. I'm going to be trampled to death. And in those moments, time just it stops, and your mind focuses like a laser beam. I didn't know what a saddle strap was, but I saw that it was there, and it wasn't buckled. It was hanging down, something I could grab onto. I grabbed onto the saddle strap, and the horse stopped. He locked all four legs and actually skidded to a stop. And that's when I realized that's not the saddle strap. Now I have a horse looking at me like, "Well, do you like me?" And that's awkward. But it proves my point, does it not, ladies and gentlemen? Every fear has a handle. Or something. I know there's a point in there somewhere. I told you that I was not good with people, and we know each other a little bit better now, so I'll tell you the whole truth. I was terrified of people. They didn't have a name for it when I was a kid. Now they call it social phobia. But I couldn't speak to people. I couldn't answer the phone in the house that I grew up in. If I was out walking and I didn't know what time it was, I had to walk until I saw a clock because I couldn't say, "Excuse me, what time is it?" I'm not afraid of people anymore, and the reason why is very simple. I found out I had something that I could give. I could tell a silly story, I could do a couple of tricks, and when I was focused on giving, I was fine. The fear was gone, because I had found the handle for any fear of people, any social fear at all. I'd found the handle for people. Every relationship you've ever had is a very simple machine. It only has two parts, like this knife has two parts. There's what goes in, and there's what comes back. I was always focused on what comes back. What am I going to get out of this? But that's a blade. You can't grab onto that. The handle was there the whole time, though. How can I be of service? What can I pack into this? That was it. It was just that simple. And it opened up vistas for me. My fears didn't all go away. I still have other fears. I was afraid of making mistakes. I've made stupid mistakes. I got in an argument with a traffic cop once. You don't want to do that. You really don't. I didn't come to a complete stop at a stop sign, but I slowed way down. And I told him, "Hey, I slowed way down." And he said, "It's not the same as stopping." And I said, "It's practically the same as stopping. I slowed way down." He said, "It's not the same as stopping." I said, "It is." He said, "It's not." I said, "It is." He took out his nightstick and he started hitting me over the head with it. He said, "No, you want me to slow down or you want me to stop?" He made his point. So yeah, I don't like making mistakes. I wanted to be psychic so I would never make mistakes anymore. And I even developed an ability. Watch this. This is a genuine psychic gift. There's no way to explain it. Right now, sir, I'm thinking of a number between 1 and 10. Quickly, what is it?
2.
2 is correct. They're laughing, but you were thinking 2, weren't you? Yeah, okay. I'm going to prove that this is real. I have a deck of cards here. And let me come over here and ask you to take a good look at this deck of cards. I want you to look at each and every card front and back. That's good enough. All right. No, go ahead and take a look. All right. And they're different suits. They're different numbers and all that. They're not stuck together or anything like that. Right. Okay. I'll take those and I'll give you this. This is a penny. Okay. Hang on to that. We'll get to that in a second. What is your name, sir?
Vahe.
That is correct. All right. Vahe. I'm going to pick a card from out of this deck and show it to everyone in the audience except you. Then I'm going to send you a mental image of the card. And out of 52 cards, you're going to name the right one on the first try without making a single mistake. You ready to give it a shot?
Absolutely.
All right, go ahead and turn and face the back of the room. And I'm going to go ahead and pick a card. First, I have to make sure that Vahe is not peeking. Okay, no, he's not peeking. He's not looking. Okay, I'm showing the card. I'm showing the card to the audience. You see it over there? Okay. All right, Vahe, you can turn around. I have the card hidden. All right. Concentrate on this card. Let me give you a little tip. Don't try to think of the number and the suit at the exact same time. Because if I'm trying to send you the number and you're trying to get the suit, we'll just go blank. So just work on the number first, just the number. Is the card that I'm holding against my chest right now a high card or is it a low card? He thinks it's a low card. Concentrate on the number of the card. I'm going to send you an image from my mind to your mind. I'll give you three tries. First number that pops into your head.
He's getting a three.
All right. Concentrate on the suit. Concentrate. Open your mind. Concentrate. I'll give you a hint. It's reddish, and it's kind of heart-shaped. Concentrate.
I think it's the three of hearts.
The three of hearts. That's amazing. I'm sorry. You're wrong. I needed you to be wrong so I could say this. It's not a disaster, is it? In fact, it's kind of funny because it's not us and it's just him who screwed up. But if it's not a disaster, why was I so terrified of making mistakes? Because I thought my mistakes would be too costly. I literally thought I could not afford a mistake, and your mistake is going to cost you.
What's it going to cost me?
It's going to cost you the penny. Oh. Yeah, I'm very sorry about that, but here's the cool part. The penny actually buys you something. It buys you a little wisdom. And that's what mistakes are for. It's a weird expression when you think about it to say that we make mistakes, like we manufacture them. It'd be better to say that we're born with a nice supply of mistakes, and then we spend them. We spend them on learning things. You guys are here in part to learn. There's no way to do that without spending a few mistakes. No way at all. And there was no way for me to show you without Vahe helping me out. So give him a big round of applause. Will you? Okay, I feel bad because I took your penny. So I'm going to give you a chance to win some money. Don't open that up. There's a piece of card paper there, and there's something drawn on it. It's a circle or it's a square. It's one or the other. It's not like a square with rounded corners. It's nothing goofy like that. It's a circle or it's a square. And in a second, I'm going to have you say circle or square. But here's the really interesting thing. I already know what he's going to say. That's how this whole trick works. I mean, it's not because I'm going to give him hints or anything. And we didn't arrange anything, did we?
No.
But I know what he's going to say. I know what Vahe's going to say. And you might be saying, well, big deal. It's circle or square. It's 50-50. Well, let's put a little money on this. It's a gambling establishment. This is a $1 bill. Okay, you're not impressed. How about this? Here we go. This is a $100 bill. $100 says, I know what Vahe's going to say. And you're not betting anything, by the way. I'm making the bet. If I lose, you win $100 just for playing the game. That's how it works. But $100 is really not that much money. So, Vahe, how do you spell your name?
V-A-H-E.
And your last name?
Are you ready?
Yeah. You're making this up. Okay. Gukasian?
Absolutely.
All right. So I have just signed a check over to you. And would you please say how much this check is for?
It is for $10,000.
For $10,000. Okay. So now, $10,000 says, I know what Vahe's going to say. That's a little bit more interesting, isn't it? So here's how it's going to work. I'm going to count 1, 2, 3, and you're going to say one word, circle or square. And then three interesting things are going to happen, and I'll point them out as they arise, okay? So you ready to go?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3.
Square.
Okay. Here's the first interesting moment. Vahe has made his guess. Last time he guessed three of hearts, and I goofed around with him, and I changed it. I can't change it. If it's a square, he wins $10,000. I can't touch it. I'm going to get nowhere near it. And it's possible that I will lose. I've lost money doing stupid things before. I gave a friend of mine $20,000 once for plastic surgery. $20,000 for plastic surgery. He got his whole face redone. You're supposed to pay me back? I have no idea what he looks like now. So, Vahe, the only question is, did you guess right or did you guess wrong? So take a good look at this check, all right? It's the last time you're going to see it because that is, in fact, a circle. And I'll take that back now. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Oh, well, okay, here's the second interesting moment. You could unclip that and look at it.
Okay.
and see that it is in fact a circle and you guessed wrong. Or you could trust me. You could choose to trust me with $10,000 on the line. Think of the courage that would take. Think of the example you'd be setting to other people. Talk about going to 212 degrees. That's amazing. $10,000 on the line and you just trust me. People be walking behind you, slapping you on the back, saying, "What the hell is wrong with you?" Go ahead and open it up. You guessed square. And it is, in fact,
a circle.
It's a circle. Yeah, it's a circle. I'm sorry. So you do not win the $10,000. But here's the interesting third moment. I said that he would win $100 just for playing the game. Did I not? Did he play the game? He wins the $100. Give him a round of applause. Drinks are on Vahe. Fear tells us that if we don't play, we can't lose, but if we don't play, we can't win either. 90% of success is just showing up. Just showing up. That makes all the difference in the world. Of course, you can't stop there. You have to commit. You have to give that extra. You have to go to 212 degrees. You have to commit with your whole heart. And that's scary. I'll prove it. By a show of hands, who here is in love? Okay, those hands down. Who here is really glad that other person isn't here to see that your sorry hand didn't go up? Yeah. Your hand shot up. How did you know you were in love? Did you feel it? Did you feel giddy and dizzy and flush and butterflies and faint and nauseated and all of that stuff?
Sure,
because that's food poisoning. Is she with us here? No. Did she laugh? No. Would you die for her? Yeah, no hesitation. And same question, your hand went up too. Would you? You would. And do you even know his wife? Hey, he's nodding. Yes, I do. That's a first. I'm using love as an example of a commitment that can be frightening, and it's just one that we've all been through. I've been through it. There's a time when I was in love with the most beautiful, the most brilliant, and the most unique three women I'd ever met in my life. And I had to choose. So I will show you how I made the commitment with a little visual metaphor. I had to pick one. I took one bite on the right-hand side, and I started thinking right away, hey, I'm just getting one little bite on the right-hand side now, so to speak. What if I took one bite on the right and one bite on the left? That's not hurting anybody. What if I take two bites on the right and two bites on the left? I started thinking, what if I take three bites on the right? And pretty soon I decided I want to have everything all the time. You people in the back are going to love this. I'm going to spit all over you. And so, ladies and gentlemen, what have we learned? I don't know. I was still afraid. I was still afraid to give my all to one thing. I wasn't ready to go to 212 degrees. I was scared. I thought if I gave my all to one thing, I'd miss out on something else. And I was. I was missing out on everything that I already had. If you're ever afraid and all you're afraid of is something you want might not come your way, please take a moment and look at what you already got. It's the handle of gratitude. And I didn't have, yeah, go ahead. I didn't have that handle of gratitude till something happened to me. I was in an accident. I was in a hang gliding accident. I told somebody I was in a hang gliding once, and they said, "You got hit by a hang glider?" No. I was flying a hang glider, and I crashed. And people asked me two questions. They say, "How did it happen?" If you don't fly unpowered gliding aircraft, it's difficult to explain. But technically, I hit the ground. And then people ask, why did it happen? That's a more interesting question. It happened because I was more afraid of living than I was afraid of dying. Living was scaring the hell out of me. It really was. Courage is not facing death. Courage is facing life. It's going to 212 degrees. It's giving your all every day. That was scaring me because it meant that if I failed, I couldn't say that I wasn't really trying. I'd have to say that I wasn't the man I wanted to believe I was. And dying didn't mean much to me because I figured all I lost was my life and I wasn't that happy with it at the time. And it wasn't because my life was bad. My life was good. I just didn't understand then that good is often the enemy of great. I had great dreams and my life got good and I decided I'd better let good be good enough. I'd let the great dreams go. I let them die. And a piece of me died with them. And I didn't know it until a friend of mine asked me if I wanted to go hang gliding with no lessons. Let's just strap it on and jump off a cliff. And I said, hey, what the hell? And then it turned out that what the hell is a bad attitude for a pilot. You don't want to fly what the hell airlines. You really don't. I crashed on my first flight. I hit an outcropping of rocks at almost 50 miles an hour. It shattered my rib cage. Shards of rib tore open my right lung. I was bleeding internally. We were 2 hours away from the nearest hospital, and we had to climb down off the mountain just to get to the car. So by the time I got to the ER, I lost too much blood. I stopped breathing, and then my heart stopped beating. And then, they brought me back. And to this day, I think there's a reason they brought me back, and that is I was fully insured. I don't know why I got a second chance, but I got the best handle. I got the best handle of my whole life out of it, and it's perspective. And I need some help. I need Daniel Balthazar to come up here and help me out. Where is he? Oh, brilliant. Come on up, buddy. Oh, yeah, there's stairs on the other side here. Thank you so much. Do, 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 do. Hi. You were selected because you have a watch on, don't you?
I do.
Yes, can I borrow your watch?
You can.
All right, beautiful. Ooh, it looks like a nice watch, too. Okay. All right, so a watch isn't just a timepiece. A watch represents something. It represents a little status. That's okay. We give ourselves this present, and we celebrate it. So this is going to represent a little bit of status, Daniel. And I have something else here. This is a 12-pound bowling ball. It's heavy, it's weighty, it's dark. I like to call this fate. We have also a ping pong ball, throws everything out of balance, so I call this chance. So this is life. There's stuff we value. Along comes fate and chance that threatens that value. And where are the handles? Well, we're going to show them. Are you ready?
Ready.
All right, stretch out right down here. Yeah. Lie down on the stage there. Beautiful. Okay, let me get you a pillow. We'll make this towel here because this is wood underneath this. Oops, sorry. Just put your head there, sorry. I'm okay. Okay. You can put your hands anywhere you want. A lot of guys go back and forth on this one for a while. It's up to you. All right, before I do this stunt for real, I have to do it once in my imagination. Okay, this will be over before you know it. But your chances are really good. What are the odds I'd blow this 3 times in a row? Yeah! Woo! Brilliant. Let me ask you one thing. When you're lying down there, were you thinking about the watch?
No.
No, he wasn't. Give him another big round of applause, and thank you, Daniel. Thank you. Can anybody guess why Daniel was not thinking about status when he was lying down there on the stage with a 12-pound bowling ball flying over his head? He had a little perspective. That's why. We all know that we have to take risks if we want to win. We really have to take risks, but we forget what we're risking. It feels like life and death, but that's not what we're risking. 9 times out of 10, we're risking a little status or a little self-image or a little ego. And when you can take that step back and use the handle of perspective, and you can risk ego, then you can play to win instead of playing not to lose. It's another way to get to 212 degrees. I don't remember this all the time. Sometimes I'm up here, I'm doing a stunt, and in the back of my head, I hear a voice, and the voice says, man, if you blow this, people are going to think you're an idiot. And then I remember, I am an idiot. So it doesn't change anything if you know. You can't take yourself too seriously. You got to lighten up once in a while and do something silly. I'll show you what I mean with a little interpretive dance. Can I have some music, please? You got to lighten up once in a while. Oh boy, you don't know where that's been. I'll tell you something about me that's odd. I don't know, maybe it's not that strange. I don't like change. I really don't like change. It's one of the reasons that I got into juggling, because juggling is like 10,000 years old, and there's no change. There's nothing new in juggling. There's been nothing new in juggling in years. Till now. This is a 1.5 million volt stun gun. 1.5 million volts is enough juice to knock a grown man off his feet. I'm not asking you to take my word for that, so Daniel, will you stand up for a second? 1.5 million volts. To that we add, that's 3 million volts, and altogether, 4.5 million volts of electricity. It's a scientifically established fact that if I catch two of these on the wrong end at the exact same time, that will suck. But I'm going to give it a shot anyway, so give me a little mood music. Let's rock and roll! That's not rock and roll. That's the wrong mood. Give me something with a positive message of some kind. It's impossible. All right, that's close enough, I guess. All right, here we go. Change is good. Change is good, so why are we so afraid of change? Many of us, most of us, I am. It is because it gets it right at the heart of what fear is all about. What is fear? Aristotle had the best definition. He said, fear is the presentiment of harm. And all that means is fear is what you feel when you're expecting something bad. Like you go to the dentist to get your teeth cleaned, and he takes a look in there and says, I'm going to have to use gas. Then he asks you if you'd like some. Fear is not what you feel when you sort of kind of something, think something bad is going to happen someplace, sometime. Fear is what you feel when you're expecting that something bad will happen. And it's not the thing itself that's so terrible. It just happens. Now, the worst part is the expectation. Causes tension. You can almost feel the tension building now. Sometimes you can feel it better when I'm closer. Feel the tension building. Feel the tension building. and you feel tension.
Sorry, I'm sorry. She literally screamed.
Well, you have to let go of the tension, otherwise it all comes out as gas anyway. And I'll tell you everything I know about fear. It's always about one thing. I used to be able to tie a balloon. Always about one thing and always about the same thing. It's always about the unknown. We look into the unknown and we wonder what's out there that's going to hurt us. And that's not stupid. I mean, that's wise. We should do that. But you can't stop there. You can't say the unknown is just a place where bad things come from. The unknown is the birthplace of all possibilities. I used to want to be certain about everything. I really wanted to be certain. I really did. And I didn't understand that where there's certainty, there's no possibility left. The two of them can't coexist. Sometimes what's waiting for us in the unknown is miraculous. Yes, the future brings challenges, but it brings the solutions right along with them. Because the unknown is a wonderful place. It's full of amazing things, and even a little bit of magic, too. Thank you. I've been talking about the handle, the place where you can get a grip, the place where you can act or react. And I want to focus on the react part now, because we don't get to choose what happens to us, but we always get to choose what we do about it. So I'm going to give somebody a choice. In fact, I'm going to give Suzanne Turner a choice, if she'll come up and help me out. Yes. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. So I'm going to give you a choice, Suzanne. Your choice, yes. Your choice is the celery. Or the machete. It's a free choice. It's up to you. Well, you don't always get what you want. So you got the celery, and I'm going to try to chop that in half. Now, we can do this with your hands safe and protected. All you have to say is okay.
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 Wait.
No, we're going to keep your hands out of this. You're going to hold it in your teeth like this. Huh?
You know they're loving this, right?
Oh, sure. Let me get a clean edge for you here.
Oh, good. Thank you.
There you go. You can have that. All right. Quick review. Your teeth are really close to your face. They're like right up in there. So when the celery is there and the knives are flying, flinching is what we call a bad thing.
I think I might have to close my eyes. Do I want to close my eyes?
You don't have to. Because this is the point where I always suggest that we use a blindfold if that's okay with you.
It's perfect.
Okay. Oh. Take a look through there and tell me what you see.
Not a thing.
Okay. So I'm going to blindfold myself and try to chop the celery out of your face. And I don't want to get celery juice all over your lovely little dress here, so let's, I have a bib for you here.
Oh, good. Oh, look at that. That's perfect.
There you go. Okay.
All right.
All right. The safest way to do this is to line up everything perfectly and then gently pull the blindfold down into place. But would that be dangerous enough? No. I thought it was, but apparently you're just a little mispopular. So I will line up everything perfectly and pull the blindfold down. Then I will take 10 paces away, and I'll try to work my way across the stage until I find you again. And when this
you're
works, it's
amazing.
You're going
to get a lot of fans here right now.
So you're going to do three things. We have to focus on the handle, and the handle is what you can do. So you're going to be biting down.
Right. Got it.
Standing still.
Standing still.
And doing one other thing that you're already doing, so I'm not even going to mention it. You're already doing it. Okay?
Okay.
All right, here we go.
Uh-uh.
Hands at your side.
I know.
All right, here we go.
Yeah.
That's good.
Good.
Okay. Top of your head.
Don't do the 10 paces.
All right. Is that the celery there?
Uh-huh.
Good. Otherwise, you should get that removed, whatever it is. Okay. 10 paces. One.
Oh, I hate you
two,
guys.
Three. Four.
That's almost the edge.
Five. Six. Wait a minute. 10. I'm going to seal the blindfold so no light can leak in around the edges. Okay.
All right.
Try to remember that at no time am I in any danger. All right, if you're still here, you're doing a great job.
I am still here, William.
Follow my directions. Otherwise, as the Japanese say, you could lose face. Very slowly and very carefully, stick your head into the spinning blades. Okay, I got a better idea. We're going to use one knife, just one knife. And on the count of three, I will chop the celery in half. One. Two. And you don't want to see this, do you? Three. There we go.
That was great.
Do me one quick favor before you leave. Take one more look through this and tell me what you see now.
A little bit of something as you get closer.
Yeah. You know why you can see now, not before? Because when you take risks, windows open up that you didn't know were going to be there.
So thank you very much.
Give her another big round of applause. Thank you. Whew. I'm going to finish up here by facing two of my deepest fears. I was scared of people, but I had a morbid fear of heights and fire my whole life. So for heights, I brought this. This is a 6-foot unicycle. It's a difficult and dangerous trick just climbing and riding this in this small area. But what Daniel is going to attempt to do, I'm going to ride this unicycle, and while I ride the unicycle, I will juggle three torches dipped in fuel. Now, as I said, I've always been afraid of heights and fire, and I never knew why until I went into Freudian analysis. And a lot of people say, that doesn't really work, does it? The talking cure? Well, you know what? We traced my fear of heights and fire. Traced it back to an incident that happened when I was just 5 years old, when my mom lit me on fire and shoved me off the roof. We think that's where it started. All right. I said that the handle is where I can get a grip, but sometimes I can't get a grip. Sometimes only we can get a grip. Sometimes it's teamwork or nothing at all. So this is going to be a teamwork task. I'm going to ask for my last two volunteers to come up. Would you come up and help me out? And you too, sir. Would you come on up? Give them a round of applause. They're my last two volunteers. All right. Thank you so much. Okay, what I want you to do is grab this unicycle just like this and put your right foot in front of the tire. Brace it. Okay, you're going to mirror him. You grab the unicycle also, right? And yeah, that's good. And put your right foot behind the tire. That's good. So all you have to do now is muscle up and hold this still. Just muscle up. Muscle up. You guys work out? Okay, on the count of three, I will leap to the seat in one graceful motion. One, two, three. Here we go. Leaping to the seat in one graceful motion.
Oh, man, he's like a pro.
Okay, go ahead and remove your feet. Okay, let go with your hands, too. Okay, and you on my left, I want you to go take your seat to the sound of thunderous applause. Okay, do you mind staying up and helping me for a minute longer? No, that's good. Okay, what I want you to do is to grab one of those torches by the silver handle. Hold the wick end up for me to light. Yeah, just one right now. Try to stand still if you can. Okay, whoop. Okay, give me this one. Get a second one down there. It's right down there. And grab that last one. Go ahead and grab the last one. And we will light the final torch. We are lighting the final torch. We are lighting the final torch. You have fire too. You can just put them together. Yeah. Give me those. Go take a seat. Give them a round of applause. This is where the performer warns the audience, please don't any of you attempt this trick at home. But I figured there's so many stupid people in the world, we can afford to lose a couple. Smoke alarms work good in here. That's good to know. We go, Aaron. Up, 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 up. Oh. want to leave you with one thought. That fire, like fear, can surround you. And if you try to run from it, it will just creep in. Sooner or later, you have to face your fear. Or not. No, you do. Because in the end, it turns out there's just one way out of fear. That's through it. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you.